Okay, we're gonna start with a book trailer. That's a couple minutes, then I'll do a little presentation, last like 20, and then we'll do question and answer, if that works, okay? Start it up.
I knew my name was Mara. That much I did know. But everything else, I didn't know why I was there, or even where there was. Then I met the messenger. He knew my name. He had something to show me. He said, "So many people do bad things, even good people. The world we live in rests on a knife's edge, and someone needs to maintain the balance. Who should be punished? Who is guilty? And what is the price they will have to pay for their redemption?" It's time to offer up a game. Play or pay. I didn't understand what it all had to do with me, but I found out soon enough.
Thank you, that's it, we're done. Hi, I'm Michael Grant, I'm a writer. One of the weird things about being a writer is that most of your life you're writing, not surprisingly, but about twice a year you turn into a traveling salesman and they send you out on the road. I've never been good at that. Probably I just don't enjoy it, and it's not how I like to talk to people. I like talking to fans, I like talking to readers, I like talking to kids, and I like writing, but somehow going around like that door to door doesn't work. What I am, though, is a writer. I've actually written something like, either with my wife or alone, something like 150 books. We kind of stopped counting at that point, because every time we count, the number comes out different, but approximately 150 books. We did a lot of ghostwriting for Sweet Valley Twins. We did a lot of work for Disney, doing spin-off books, or for Aladdin and Jasmine and Mermaid and Donald Duck and Mickey Mouse. We actually at one point wrote a craft book for Mickey Mouse, which is strange given that neither of us has the slightest idea what to do with a craft or how to make anything. Apparently nobody died, so that's good. But we just made up some bologna, some recipes and some stuff and pretended we knew what we were doing, which kind of, I think, describes my career. When we started out writing, my wife and I were poor and old. I had met my wife in Austin, Texas, after hitchhiking into town, after jumping bail, after committing a couple of burglaries of a business. So I was living under a bridge, a freeway overpass, off I-35 for a while. Eventually got a job in a restaurant as a busboy, got on as a waiter after that, made enough to get an apartment, which is like a crappy apartment, but way better than the freeway overpass and the school library where I used to sleep. In any case, one day I looked through a window, it happened to be the apartment right next to mine. I saw this girl, and I am the last person on earth who does this kind of thing, but I just decided at that moment, I don't know why, but I gotta go meet that girl. And so I went over and knocked on her door and lied and said I didn't have a can opener. And 24 hours later, we had moved in together, and we've been together ever since. We've been together for 36 years. She was engaged at the time, I know. I know. I would feel bad, but it worked out great for me. So for years after that, she was at University of Texas and she was just graduating. And like I say, I was, you know, I was a complete screw up. And so for like the next 7-8 years, we did various dead end jobs. Mostly I worked in restaurants. I waited tables a lot. I will tell you that to this day, I'm 61 years old now. I haven't waited tables in, I don't know, 35 years. But if you woke me up out of a sound sleep and said, "What are you?" There's still a 50-50 chance I go, "I'm a waiter." And as a matter of fact, my back, to this day, my back is screwed up from doing this with trays and running up and down stairs. Never recovered from it. So we did that for a while, and then we sank even lower So by the end, we had a cleaning service on Cape Cod. We were cleaning homes during the day and offices at night. And there was something about the prospect of scraping people's shit stains out of toilets that made my wife think, this is not great. And I couldn't disagree. And she said, we need to get careers and do something with our lives. And I said, okay, what? And she said, let's write. So I said, okay. So that was the thought that went into the whole thing. Somebody earlier today asked me what courses I took in college. Not many. I dropped out of high school after finishing 10th grade, and well, the first 2 days of 11th grade, and then I quit. And then sometime later went to college, and I think lasted a semester, maybe part of a second semester, but mostly I was just getting stoned. So that's my educational background. However, I do want to say, don't do that. You know, I live near the Golden Gate Bridge. People jump off the Golden Gate Bridge and die all the time. Every now and then, some lucky son of a bitch jumps off the bridge and actually lives. That does not make jumping off the bridge a good idea. So the fact that I managed to pull something out of this, that's not a career path for rational people to follow. So basically, yes, I'm here to sell you books, but I find selling books boring. So instead, I thought I would talk to you about the big question that every writer gets asked all the time. Where do you get your ideas? And I never have a good idea. I never have a good answer. What?
Pod.
No, so, well, no. No, that happened much. That happened. Where do you get your ideas? And so I usually come up with some smart-ass answer like, I buy them at Target. You don't want to play that game at elementary schools. When I was selling younger books in elementary schools, kids would go, okay, what section? And I would have to tell them. Go get them right next to the Tide in the detergent. Where do you get your ideas? Now, this made me think about the entire question of creativity, which brings us back to creation. So let's go back to the source on creation, which is Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Then John 1:1 says, a little variation, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, or some version of that. Genesis says God created, and John offers some philosophical house cleaning by equating God and the Word and asserting that God came before creation, which you do want because you want your creator to precede the thing he creates in theory. The longer version, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth was without form and void, and darkness is upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And right now, everybody's going, oh my God, is this a religious thing? And God said, let there be light, and there was light, and God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness, and God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning were the first day. Well, this is exactly the kind of confused answer I used to give when asked about my own creation. So let's get this straight. God, darkness moved upon the face of the waters before water was created, and then you created the earth, which was without form and void, even after you created it? Or did it exist in a void, which is a contradiction in terms? Either way, it's nonsense. And then the whole long bit about night and day. Day and night are a function of the rotation of the earth, turning first one side and then the other toward the sun. Would have thought you knew that, Jehovah. Cheap special effect, I know. So where was light coming from at the point where there was no sun? Was he just standing there with a reading light, flipping it up and down? That's another day, that's another day. Days are flying by, baby, this is great. But as much trouble as I had with it, I was not quite as bad as this guy on Goodreads who gave it only 1 star. Now, as a narrative, it might only deserve 1 star, I don't know, but I don't have that kind of nerve because, exactly. Because you never know, that's why. But at another level, I understand Jehovah's problem because it is a hell of a hard thing to walk an idea back, having had it, and figure out where it came from. I don't know. I used to say, well, there's like a person who lives in the back of my head and just makes stuff up, which was as close as I can come. Fortunately, technology has come to our rescue in the shape, in my case, of a little thing called Deep Dream, which is a Google program, a Google neural net. I don't know if you've heard of it, but this is an example of Deep Dream's work. This image began as a simple photograph of a human hand. That image is then fed into the deep dream neural net, which is an artificial neural net, as the name implies. Basically, it's a computer simulation of the most primitive type of learning machine. Digital neurons are connected, then they are fed a very simple database of imagery without software telling it what to do. It just has pictures loaded into it, and then it's left on its own to try to make sense of any subsequent data. So if you give it a second picture, it tries to make sense of that, and it tries to understand it, basically. Now, in this case, Google's Deep Dream was fed a database heavy on pictures of dogs and buildings and a couple of other things, but those themes, as you'll see, start to come up again and again, and especially eyeballs. Deep Dream loves itself some eyeballs. This is a picture I took, a photograph of me standing in front of a painting, and then I had my son give it the Deep Dream treatment. Now, as you can see, Deep Dream thought I needed some eyeballs, randomly stuck here and there, and then it put dogs in my t-shirt and faces here and there. It looked for what it knew in a picture that it didn't understand and tried to make sense out of it. And what it looked for was what it knew, in effect. Many of the images that come out of this are beautiful. A lot of them are disturbing, and I think this is because we are, in effect, when we look at these, eavesdropping on what feels like a very alien consciousness, either alien or insane. Many of them look like a vision of madness or drug-induced hallucination. I'm not the first to suggest that these images are very reminiscent of experiences on LSD or shrooms. And I'm not the first to compare them with descriptions given by people who suffer from schizophrenia and other severe mental illnesses, which makes me think that Deep Dream and humans aren't so far apart when it comes to creativity. Deep Dream's deepest dreams bear an unsettling similarity to our nightmares. So if I were to drop acid and see what Deep Dream sees, or what a severely mentally ill person sees, or what I might see in my own nightmares, then is it possible that there are deep structures in our own consciousness which we learn to suppress or to redirect, but that nevertheless persist? Is it possible that hallucination and madness and dreams are all more true than what we think of as truth? So look at this picture again, and what I find interesting is look at the painting behind me, and look at how little Deep Dream finds to change in that. It's as though this alien consciousness looks at that abstract painting and goes, yeah, that's about right. But the picture of the fat guy with the bald head, we're gonna have to add some eyeballs on that for that to make any kind of sense at all. In this one you see whole new creatures appear in the background of the shot. Now this is a photograph of a pizza, somebody pulling a slice out of the pizza, and then that image is fed to Deep Dream. Now here's what's interesting about this. Look at some of the things that appear. Look over there in the upper left-hand corner, what looks like a shadowy dog. There's nothing there in the original photograph. That is an act of creation. That is an act of imagination. That's something that didn't exist before that. And it's created by the simplest kind of computer mind you can possibly imagine. An IQ of zero, essentially. It knows nothing, except it knows itself some dogs, and it knows itself some eyeballs. And it likes them both. So it sticks them in here and there, taking a little bit that's there, a little clue or a little hint, and sometimes nothing at all, and just creating something that didn't exist before that. So, depending on how you look at it, either God or God's scribe or some random Hebrew, depending on your point of view, tried and failed in Genesis to make sense of the creative process. At least if you're expecting rationality. If you're expecting a linear narrative, Genesis makes no sense at all. And now, thousands of years later, Deep Dream seems to suggest that creation may be just a bit like insanity or hallucination or a nightmare. Now, you want to see an image that would come straight out of the mind of a lunatic? There is not a horror movie director in Hollywood who would not be proud to have created that little monster right there. That is creepier than anything you've ever seen in a movie. And it's just, that is the work of a neural net. Not even a computer. Calling it a computer is too much. It's just a neural net. And then, of course, there's something like this. But, of course, that's not from Deep Dream. That's from Hieronymus Bosch, who painted it 500 years ago. It's part of his vision of hell. And a more famous picture, Starry Night by Vincent van Gogh. Now, a long time ago, back when I was a kid, I was asking myself then, is this Van Gogh's invention, or is Van Gogh painting exactly what he saw? In other words, is that the night sky, as far as Vincent van Gogh is concerned? There's no way to know, obviously. Who's got the truth on that? Maybe if Vincent van Gogh could have taken a picture, a photograph of his own subjective impressions, it might have looked exactly like that. So, who sees the true night sky, Van Gogh or you, or me? Who truly sees reality, us or Deep Dream? Which is real, the world we see every day, or the world we see in a drug-induced hallucination? Is it not possible that all of us have the distorted view and only the madman and the dreamer get it right? So look at this picture, and what you see here is before and after. They're not particularly beautiful photographs, but here's what's cool about it. You can actually imagine yourself sitting by the edge of the lake, looking across it at this forbidding pile of rock, and creating imagery around it to make it more interesting, to make it tell a story, to make it more fantastic. And Deep Dream did exactly that. The precise act of creation that you and I would have staring up at the sky or staring across at a landscape where we would come up with, you know, adding in details, adding in characters, is all being done by Deep Dream. So perhaps none of us are any different than Deep Dream, except instead of looking for dogs and eyeballs and pagodas everywhere, we're looking for our own hang-ups, our own prejudices, our own preferences, our own internal crazy, our own weird. And maybe that's it. I mean, in my case, maybe I'm just crazy. I know. It's a nightmare, isn't it? The truth is, since I was a little kid, some of my earliest memories, I've always had conversations going on in my head between people who didn't actually exist. It's been a constant feature. It's running all the time. It's like a show going on. It's like when your computer's running other programs in the background and kind of slows down because something else is running in the background. That's my brain pretty much all the time. There's always some story going around. So as I sit here looking at you guys, I make up stories about you. I make up stories that, you know, maybe the roof will fall in and we'll all have to get out of here somehow. I don't know, I haven't figured that out yet. Or maybe, you know, there'll be the big killer earthquake in California. How the hell am I gonna get home? I don't know, what am I gonna do? So this kind of stuff goes on in my head. I can't see a construction crane without picturing it toppling over and then picturing the damage that it does, the families that are destroyed, the lives that are ruined, this poor son of a bitch who was responsible for it. Oh my God, he's got to go to court. What if they throw him in jail? He already feels bad enough. This is going on constantly in my head. I'm 61 years old, like I said, and that stuff is still pretty much always there. But to a certain extent, it's there with everybody. So I want to play a little imagination game with all of you right now. I want to ask you to imagine that every wall around us, every part of every wall, is covered in a fast-moving sheath of brick, just like plop, 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 all the way down, and all the way across, and all the way down, so that every door, every window, every possible escape is completely covered, and we are completely trapped, 100% trapped in a giant vault of impenetrable brick, and there is no way for us to escape, and that's bad, but it's going to get worse, because the floor right there, right between the two rows. As a matter of fact, you're probably gonna wanna move back a little bit because a chasm opens in the floor, and out of that chasm crawl monsters. And those monsters are hungry, but they're reasonable. They don't wanna eat everybody. They just want three. And we have to give them three people to eat, or they'll kill us all. So, think about that for 15 seconds.
Go
Okay. And now I have a question for you. It's not the question you expect. The question you expect is, who we throw into them? And besides, we already know the answers, which is all the teachers. But that's not really the question, because the question is, what did the monsters look like? See, now what's interesting is, I gave you no description of the monsters, not a single piece. I just said they were bad, they were awful, they were hungry, that's it. Everything else that came out of that description came out of your heads. When that chasm opened up in the ground, did it make a sound? Because I didn't tell you. Was it dark inside, or was it full of like flames and stuff? I didn't tell you that either. Did the monsters have giant teeth? Didn't tell you. You made up that part yourselves. Now, some of it you made up out of old alien movies, granted, but some of it was just original work on your own, putting together your own imagery out of that. And that is exactly you guys playing the game. And interestingly enough, that is what writing relies on, because when I write a book, I describe a lot of things, but I don't describe everything. It's pretty sketchy, a lot of cases, description. And yet, people fall in love with characters I've written. And they go on Twitter and just rhapsodically on and on about them, and then they'll ask me, wait a minute, what color were his eyes? And I go, I haven't got a clue. Never wrote that. You did. They're whatever color you think they have to be. This is the collaboration that takes place between a writer and a reader. Without you guys pitching in your bit, my bit doesn't work. So I do half the work, you do the other half. Fortunately, though, you pay me and not the other way around, which is great, don't you think? So, lost my place, of course. So, in any case, this is as close as I can come to explaining creativity and imagination, to answering the question, where do your ideas come from? My neural net, my brain, was trained on certain images, a certain database, certain preferences, certain prejudices, certain things I like, certain things I don't like, things that scare me maybe, things that make me happy. And then after that, I stumble upon or I'm shown an image or an idea, or maybe just a word, as I just did with the word monster, and from that, I spin out an idea, which eventually becomes a book. Now, turning that into a book is the part that takes craft and skill and talent and work, is actual typing. But underneath it all, what I'm doing is nothing different fundamentally than what Deep Dream is doing. Nothing different than that. So, and then there's an interesting coda to this. When you look at that picture, what is it? It's a cheeseburger, right? Yeah, except it's not. There's no cheese, there's no burger. That bun is not a bun. What's happened is you've seen a series of disturbing, creepy, bizarre images, and you have now turned it into a hamburger. You've gone along and reversed it, and you've taken something bizarre and unsettling and made it into something familiar, which is the flip side. So I wonder how often in life that happens. How often in life we see one thing and then we turn it back into something which is safer and more easily digestible for us. It doesn't upset us. So it goes back to the question again, who sees the true night sky? Vincent van Gogh or us? Don't know. And that is my very long answer to the question, where do you get your ideas? And in a way, it's the answer to the question people sometimes ask me but are afraid to, which is there something screwed up in your head, Mr. Grant? To which I can now answer, no. But there's a lot of eyeballs. So I thought,
we there?
Yeah, okay. So I thought I'd read you a little bit of Messenger of Fear, not too much, because I know it's a drag listening to people read stuff. So this is just like a page. But I thought you might understand it better and understand kind of where it came from and the thought process behind it, having lived through all this now. Messenger of Fear is told from the point of view of Mara. The books are about good and evil, sin and redemption. They are brutal at times because I wrote them and things I write tend to be. They are morally ambiguous, so ditto. The reader is meant to feel a little uncomfortable with what Mara and Messenger are doing. They're not necessarily meant to think that's a good thing, what they're doing. But in any case, this is the opening bit of book two of Messenger of Fear. It's called The Tattooed Heart. From childhood, I suffered from occasional nightmares, featuring the most vivid monsters and the most intense of emotions. A constant theme was helplessness. I was often paralyzed in my dreams, or if I could move, it was in slow motion while everything and everyone around me moved at normal speed. I would often wake myself by screaming, deliberately, you see. In the throes of horror, I would tell myself to scream until I was awake. When my father died, my dreams changed. They became bittersweet. I had one terrible dream in which I saw him dead. After that, he was never dead, just far away. I never saw him in his casket, nor did my unconscious mind conjure the moment when an enemy's bullet took his life. He was always alive, and his eyes shone not with fear, but with regret and love. I would savor those dreams and seek to prolong them. And when at last, reluctant, I woke, I would find my pillow wet. I think maybe dreams provide a type of balance. When life is good, dreams remind you that fear still lives out there in the world. When life is bad, dreams offer hope. I am Mara. I'm 16 years old, and my dreams now are most often of my home, my school, my friends, past pets, objects I hold dear, my mother, and my ever-absent, ever-present father. They are dreams of loss and alienation, but not nightmares. Life is my nightmare now, and paradoxically, my dreams have become escapes. That's it. Thanks for listening. Appreciate it. So now I pass the hat and raise money. No, kidding. No, questions, answers. I answer all questions, even rude questions. But if you don't ask anything, then I just stand here like a moron. Yeah, dude.
So I've got these two questions.
Uh-huh.
Do you ever have any conflicts come up when you think of something very original, but you think that it might not be accepted?
Okay, he's asking if I come up with ideas sometimes that I think basically I can't sell. Yeah. I'll make no bones about the fact that I am driven by the marketplace. I think a lot about marketing. I think about selling. I like money. Like I said, I was poor. I know what poor is like. I'm pretty well off now. Comparing the two, it's really pretty easy. The rich part is so much more fun. My cars are really better. And I can buy stuff. I can go to the doctor. All that stuff. So, no, I'm very market-driven. It's got to be something that I know that's going to work. But mostly, if it'll work fictionally, if it'll hold together as a story, you can make it at least partly commercial. But do I sometimes come up with ideas and go, no. But usually, if it's no, then it's because it didn't hold together as a story. So that's the first threshold is not, will it sell? The first threshold is, do I have a story here? If I don't have a story, I'm done. So it solves the problem. It's Occam's razor. The first slice is, do I have a story? Yeah, go ahead.
Question number two. Are you ever completely pleased with your work? Or do you keep finding flaws?
Oh, that's such a smart question. Can I tell you something? Are you a writer? No. He's asking if I'm ever completely pleased with my work.
You're never pleased.
Exactly. I'll tell you something. Somebody sent me something in the mail, and it bothered me. They got me on Twitter or something and said, would you read something? And I was like, oh, Christ, okay. And it's never a good idea. I never want to do it, but somehow I ended up saying yes. And then I forgot. So she sent this to me like 8 months ago or something and then got back on Twitter. She's very polite. And then goes, dude, you said you'd look at this and I haven't heard from you. It's been 8 months. And I went, oh, Christ. So I looked at it. Now here's what was the telltale thing. It wasn't about the quality of the writing. It was the fact that she didn't give me something new and different. Because a writer would no more give you something they wrote 8 months ago that was unfinished and then give it to you exactly unchanged than they would, you know, blow their own brains out. Because in the meantime, they would have thought, I didn't do that perfectly and it has to be better. I can find another way to do it. Every time I look at anything I've ever written, I'm sitting there going, screwed that up. Shouldn't have done that. Should have. Oh man, you know what I could have done here? This would have been so much better. You always want to improve. A real writer, a person who's going to make a living at this, wants their stuff to be better and better, is never going to be completely satisfied. I'm sure that if you dragged Shakespeare out of the grave and said, Hamlet, pretty good, he'd go, yeah, but you know what? Kind of weak there around Act 3, don't you think? He'd still be thinking, you know, of ways to make it better, because that's what you want to do. So yeah, good question, though. Yeah, dude.
Me?
Yeah.
Have you ever, like, been surprised by
Have you ever not had a good book?
Yeah, I've been surprised in both directions. When we were writing Animorphs, we were writing another series simultaneously with it under a pseudonym. This other series was called Barfarama. Barfarama was exactly what it sounds like. So with my usual gift for pushing everything to the absolute limit, Barfarama was as disgusting a thing as it is possible to imagine. I used all of my skill, all of my talent to make that so full of puke and bodily excretions of one type or another. It was nauseating. 10 books of nauseating. Meanwhile, Animorphs comes in. We're coming out with Animorphs simultaneously, and we're looking at each other going, you know, Barfarama is probably going to be huge, and Animorphs is this little niche thing. Totally wrong. Barfarama sold only one place where it sold consistently. That was college bookstores. Let's think if we can imagine why a college freshman would be buying a book like Barfarama instead of doing something else. So the one that actually sold was Animorphs. That became huge. Barfarama went on to just become this hideously embarrassing thing out of my past, joining so many other hideously embarrassing things. Sometimes you think stuff will go, sometimes you don't. You just don't know. You just don't know. Publishing people always tell you, oh, yeah, I thought so. They're just, yeah, nobody knows. Yeah. Yeah.
Where were you living
before I became a writer, where was I living? Dude, it's more like where wasn't I living? So I was born in Los Angeles. I've lived in 50 homes in my life. The longest I ever lived anywhere was in Evanston for 5 years. And that was insane. We were like ready to get out of there. We've slowed down a bit since having kids, but we used to move every year. And sometimes more than that. I've lived 3-4 different houses in a year. And so it's like kind of everywhere. All across the US, and then in the Azores, Portugal briefly, Florence, Italy for a while. When I was a kid, like second, third, fourth grade, I was in France, going to French schools. I was fluent in French at the time, because we were in the army. So I've lived everywhere, kind of. And still I want to go to other places. So I want to go live in London. But I don't think I can take the weather. Yeah.
I have a few questions. The first one is, who are your big influences in writing?
My big influences in writing, well, there's one who is kind of my personal god, which you've all heard of. It's Stephen King.
Yes.
And here's why. First of all, he blurbed my book. He loved Gone. And when, you know, I get choked up to this day, I swear to God. I can barely get through it and talk about it. He blurbed my book. He liked my book. I fanboyed like a moron. It was just, you know, because it's not just that he's incredibly talented. He's a great writer. But I also like the fact he's got an amazing work ethic and outstanding energy. And I work hard. I'm a productive writer. I'm one of the most prolific writers in the English language today. Stephen King blows me out of the park. He just kills me. He's faster, he's better, and he works harder, and he knows more. And it's just so irritating. So I'm going to stalk him and kill him. No, I love, and I'll tell you something else about Stephen King. After he was already a huge success, this guy owns everything. He's got it. You can't give Stephen King anything. He's got it all. Guy runs him down. You hear about this? He got run down by a truck. He's walking down the road in Maine. God knows why he's in Maine. But okay, different people have different tastes. So a guy runs him over, very nearly kills him, breaks like dozens of bones. He's in the hospital for ages, and he's a recovering drug addict, so I think he probably had some difficulty dealing with pain medication. Comes out of that, and you would think he would just go, wait a minute, I'm a billionaire, I've got everything, why don't I just say screw it? No, he pops up and writes like a 1,000-page book, and then comes right behind that and goes, and here's another 1,000 pages. You know, it's kind of amazing, you know? He's kind of an amazing guy. Yeah, dude.
What's your favorite Stephen King album?
Probably still The Stand, because The Stand was very much in my head when I was writing the Gone series, and because I wanted something that had epic sweep. So the Gone series is 3,000 pages long, 6 books, and so I had that in mind, and actually there's a couple of Easter eggs in there for him, which nobody ever gets. There's a forest called the Stefano Rey National Forest. It's in there. Stefano Rey? Come on, Stephen King. Jesus. How hard was that? Does nobody speak Spanish? So it's a couple of shout outs to Stephen over that.
Yeah, my name
was Did you?
Yeah.
I stole a character, Drake Merwin, is my psychopath. He's the first time I've written an unambiguous psychopath. He's just pure, distilled essence of evil. Merwin is the last name of the trash can man from The Stand. So I'm sure Stephen didn't mind much. Yeah, another one? Well, shame on you.
No, I was
sitting
there looking at the tattoo card right there, and I was flipping through it. And
okay, well, that counts. Go ahead.
Have you ever tried to draw in a completely different writing style?
Oh, yeah. I do frequently. So I've got kind of my standard style. I tend to have very stripped down prose. Nobody ever is looking at me going, ooh, Michael Grant really has broken new ground on prose. So I'm a very straightforward storyteller. I'm much more interested in momentum, probably, than anything else. I'd keep it moving. And so I write in a stripped down style. However, in doing this, actually, I was trying to channel H.P. Lovecraft, because I love Lovecraft. He can't actually write a story, but boy, he can sure build up to a story. So I would have Lovecraft, I'd put him on my iPhone, go to Costco, listening to Lovecraft as I push along. So great. And it's just, you know, adverbs and adjectives just piled on each other. Just this crazy Baroque style of writing. So I started off doing that and then very quickly realized that wasn't going to fly. It just wasn't going to work with the audience that I've got. So I backed off of that. But it's still, the end result is still more ornate and more descriptive than what I usually write. And then now I've got Frontlines, which is a whole different thing. It's alternate history. So I've got to write in a whole different style and approach there, partly because instead of my usual make everything up as I go along every day, where I just improv my way through stuff, I got actual history to deal with. So I have to actually have my characters be here at this time and there at some other time, you know, using this type of machine gun here and being strafed by that kind of plane there. It's all got to fit, you know, with reality. So yeah, I mean, do I sit around practicing different prose styles? Nah. But I try to do whatever works with the story. Yeah, it's all about the story. I'll give you one more. Yeah, do you have one more? Okay. Then I'll come to you, I promise.
It's a really good question. With your scenario of like the brick and everybody trapped in here and the monsters coming out and they have to take three people, mm-hmm. Have you ever thought of the scenario and how you would get out of that situation? Like what would you do to have to save those three people and have a good outcome?
I was going to push you in, frankly. So that's my first thought. Because let's find whoever hasn't read any of my books, and let's push, feed them. No, I haven't really worked it out. You know what I need? I need the Kobayashi Maru maneuver, which the nerds will get. But, you know, because Captain Kirk in Starship Enterprise doesn't believe in the no-win scenario. So he just reprograms the scenario. So, okay, and then you're... No.
No, not. Me.
Yeah, go ahead.
Do you ever write based off what you've been through?
Not much, no. I mean, look, pieces of your own experience are going to come in there regardless, and you draw on that. But I specifically avoid anything that's autobiographical. And I also, different writers have different approaches on this. Mine is to kind of disappear. I don't want you looking at, like, if you get to a particular part and go, wow, that's a really beautiful simile, I'm not happy. I don't want you thinking about what a beautiful simile it is or what a beautiful metaphor or what a nicely chosen word. I want you thinking about the story. So for me, it's all, I'm going to shine the light on the story. I don't want you thinking about me. So I tend to kind of disappear. As much of an egomaniac as I am, when I write, I'm exactly the opposite. I'm self-effacing. And so I'm sure I'll write something about myself. My wife and I are thinking about writing an autobiography because we've had bizarre lives, you know, clearly. Yeah. Yeah.
You did Disney books, right?
Uh-huh.
Who's your favorite Disney princess?
Well, we weren't fond. We only did Mermaid and Jasmine, our only two princesses. Honestly, wasn't fond of either. But I'll tell you a classic for us editorial argument. So we're on the phone with our editor. And the big debate is, it's this three-way argument going on, whether or not Ariel could be blown out of the blowhole of a whale. And this went on for like a half an hour. Like, no, she could. It's like, no, she's way too big. I'm like, how big? A whale could be huge. It's made up. It could, of course she can fit out. We can shoot it out of its ass if we want to. This goes on for forever. This is a big debate. I didn't like any of them, honestly. I don't write women characters who are princesses. I write women characters who are women. Yeah. Or something. Or girls, at least. Yeah. Anyone else? Yeah. Is the truth sometimes better than fiction? Yeah, very often. Yeah. Yeah, you know, they just gave the Nobel for Literature to a nonfiction writer, which even us fiction people are like, yeah, about time, you know, because those people work. I've done very little nonfiction, and the hard part about writing Front Lines is that it's partly, you know, it's fiction, but it's a lot of nonfiction too, so I actually have to get my facts right. I find it very frustrating. It's not my normal way to do stuff. Yeah. I wouldn't be thrilled by it, honestly. She's asking if I would like somebody to, like, you know, do literary analysis and stuff on my books, and probably not. I remember all the way back in seventh grade, I think it was seventh grade, we had a class on interpreting American transcendentalist writers. I don't know why, but that turned me off on literature just generally. School very nearly killed any affection I had for reading and writing because of that kind of stuff. Because I was sitting there, and I hadn't written and didn't think I'd be a writer, but I'm looking at this going, your interpretation of this is just bull. The guy wrote it because that's what worked in the story, because that's what I do for a living now. I know this for a fact. Stuff is what it is because that's, 9 times out of 10, because that's how it had to be, because that's how it worked. And so a lot of fancy explanations for it tend to go way off in the ozone, and sometimes I get those myself. People go, oh, the reason he did this, and I go, dude, you know, a lot of times a word is, they'll go, I wonder where he got that word. I'll tell you where I got that word. I was sitting in my room and looking out of the window, and there was a hotel across the street, and I took the name of the hotel and mixed the letters around and made a word. So, you know, that was it. It wasn't very sophisticated. Anyway, how are we on time? About 2 minutes? Okay, who's got a 2-minute question?
You like hip hops?
No, I'm more punk. If I'm, if you look at my, the only, I was a big Eminem fan, probably because we both hate our mothers. I listen to, probably my go-to band, my default band, if you look at my playlist, it's Rancid, which is a band out of the Bay Area. Tim Armstrong, there's a million, that's the problem. You know, I can't keep up with them all. I've got a lot of Social Distortion. I've got a lot of Against Me. I've got a lot of, who else? I don't know. A bunch of people. I can never remember their names. The Distillers. Brady Dahl's off on her own. She's got one of the best voices, female voices.
I want to marry her voice.
I know. She's amazing, isn't she? I actually went and looked for her just by hearing this one song off that album. I thought, I don't know who she is, but I haven't been like hit by a voice like that since maybe Grace Slick or something. Yeah, it is. Thank you.